kindly come on stage and present a token of love to Mr. David. I'd like to invite you one more time to kindly join us on stage. And I'd like to thank you very much for all those beautiful and wonderful stories that you've shared and motivated all of us. Can we have, yes, a big, big round of applause for Mr. David. Thank you for enlightening us with those fabulous stories. Thank you very much, Mr. David. Mohan sir, samjhana ma'am, stage ma hi hudai keri ma hamro advisory board ka dui vyakti tuhar lai pani dekhdai chu, waha lai pani ma manch ma bolauna chahanchu, Mr. Upendra Pradhan, added general manager, sales, Dabur Nepal Private Limited. Sir lai pani agadi aidera, your token of appreciation, your maya kuchino lead in hunaka lagi ma anurodh gardachu. Thank you very much, sir, for being a part of our event, Sales Summit 2022. Sangsangai ma stage ma bolauna chahanchu, Mr. Rupesh Sharma Bhatta, Vice President, VG Impex Private Limited. Sir, lai pani dherai dherai dhanyabad, yahanko bahulya ideas, sujhav diera hamro yes karyakram lai aja nikhar dinu bhayeko ma. Thank you so much. Thank you very much, sir. Mohan sir, samjhana naam lai pani dherai dherai dhanyabad. Thank you for doing the honors. So ladies and gentlemen, after the first session, it is now time to move for the second session of the day. So euta vinamra anurodh yahan sabai jana lai chai aphno mobile phone se kripaya silent mode ma rakhi dinuka lagi anurodh garna chahanchu. Silent mode, vibration mode ma rakhi dinu hola. आज बिहान यहाँ आने पर्च कति जानले अलार्म पनि राख्नु भएको थियो होला, त्यो पनि बस्न सक्छ. सो अलार्म पनि अफ गर्दिनु भयो हुन्छ. नाउ दैट यू अलरेडी हियर इन दिस इभेन्ट, राइट? सो आई लाइक टू रिक्वेस्ट अल अफ यू टू काइन्डली गो थ्रू योर मोबाइल फोन्स एन्ड किप देम इन साइलेन्ट मोड एन्ड सो द्याट यु नो अल यु फोकस अल यु अटेन्सन किन बी टुवर्ड्स आवर नेक्स्ट स्पिकर एज वेल. The next speaker we have is Mr. Amlan Mukherjee, who is the MD and CEO of Unilever Nepal, our keynote speaker. His session will talk about sales optimization through digital transformation. Mr. Amlan Mukherjee has been working as the Managing Director and Chief Executive Officer of Unilever Nepal Limited starting April 2020. He has 30 plus years of experience in this industry, spanning through general management, brand management, sales and marketing roles, working in a different capacity in global roles as well as in South Asia. His journey in this organization started in the frontline sales and later moved to core marketing. He has also led different businesses in Unilever. And currently, he's also the part of Unilever Global Team along with Unilever South Asia Leadership Team. I also had the privilege to be with him a few days ago for a Unilever event where a digital transformation was also, I think, a key part of that concept as well. So ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together in welcoming Mr. Amlan Mukherjee.
Good morning to you all, and thanks for the kind introduction. I'll change the introduction a bit before I start. I joined this organization 31 years back, and I borrow from my something which my CEO of Unilever, Mr. Nitin Paranjabe, some of you must have heard him, my ex-boss, he said a couple of years back. He said that whatever we do, I can be the CEO, I can be the CEO and all, but the first thing, what I am for the organization, my first role is to sell, second role is to sell, and third role is to sell, right? Everything else, understand the role. And I joined this organization 31 years back as a trainee territory sales in charge, right? So everything, and what I have realized when I built my team, that every other function, and I'm sure there are people from all functions sitting over here, so don't take it in another way, function is a support function. The revenue generation of the organization is being done by the sales team, right? And myself, after 31 years, I must say that I feel privileged to be part of the sales team first for my organization. Even now when I go to any town and a couple of my colleagues are here, I tell them never say that I am visiting a town. Say that I am working in that town, right? It has lots of difference. Because we as salespeople, we don't visit, we work, right? It has nothing to do with danger. I thought that being part of one of you, I should share something before I start my presentation. I shall start my presentation by telling you a story. A story which happened some 5-6 months back, and it can bring alive a fantastic way something which I'm going to speak in the next 35-40 minutes. Any of you over here or some of you over here from automobile industry? I'm assuming some of you will be, I can see some of the hands. So while I stay in Kathmandu, my daughter stays in Bombay, right? So we decided that I should buy her a car because she has to go to office. Some of those times, Bombay traffic is extremely, extremely sad. And from where we stay to her office, there is no direct train. So we decided to buy a car. So we approached a certain company, we had a preference. And the sales gentleman over there had a very brief informal discussion with me. He asked me about what's my name, what do I do, what's my daughter's name, what does she do, and what is the purpose of buying this car, right? And then invited us to come to the showroom on the next Saturday. When we went to the showroom, me and my daughter, yes, my wife was also there, when we went to the showroom, so here was me and my daughter, and there was a salesperson. First and foremost, my question to all of you is that can you tell us what was the role difference between me and my daughter in that particular transaction? We went to buy a car. I went there. I was buying the car for my daughter, so I went there and my daughter. So what's the role difference between? First and foremost, and this is something which all of you should remember, is that the role difference is that my daughter is the consumer and I am the shopper, right? It is not necessary always that the shopper and the consumer are the same, right? You buy a toy for somebody close. Are you the consumer? No, you are not the consumer. What you are? You are the shopper. You are shopping. So in most of the cases, the salespeople deal with the shoppers and the consumers are a subset of the whole thing. There can be cases where the consumers are also, consumers are shoppers, right? Now, what happened is that this guy, while he was giving his sales speech, he first approached my daughter and told her that, ma'am, you work for OVP head office is in X place, which is 35 kilometers away from where you stay. You work in the creative department. It means that you leave office late. At that point of time, coming home takes around 1.5 hours to 2 hours, depending on the traffic. You must be very tired. And then he suggested a car, which is an automatic car, which is a good maneuverable car, which was not of a very high price to her, and told her, what are the advantages of her driving that car while going to the office and coming back, and I say something. Then he approached me. And then he told me, sir, I believe that you already have a car. So this is one car which has a high resale value. And you stay in Kathmandu. Your daughter stays in Bombay. So the service center from your home is only 4 kilometers away. And these are the other facilities which we'll bring on to facilitate the car. I was so impressed and surprised. This guy, during the first discussion, you know what he did later on when I checked? He went to both our LinkedIn profile and checked our profile and found out what we do, right? And created a sales story which was one for the consumer, who is my daughter, and one for the shopper, which is me. For me, it is all about efficiency. If there is a problem for the car, how will my daughter should not run from pillar to post and so on. So that's what is important for me. And for my daughter, it is about the style of the car, the maneuverability of the car, the ease of driving of the car, you know. And he created this story by visiting our LinkedIn pages. Both of us, we are here in LinkedIn, and which are open pages, right? Now, what does it tell you? Before I explain to you, and I'll explain to you, and I'll tell you how do I take it. How many of you heard of this term called big data? I'm sure, sir, you have. But let me try and explain to you in a very easy terms what is big data. So say suppose an oil company has found that there is a store of oil, there is a huge oil field in Venezuela, and which is below the surface. You know, that oil has no price, no value. Here, when they extract the oil, they process the oil, right, and they make it user ready, then that oil has a value. Exactly like this, in our everyday life, there are millions, billions, and trillions of data which are getting passed on in what we do. Whether it is the media platform, the digital platform, whether you are using the social media, everything, when you are traveling and if you have kept your GPS on, your location on, there are billions and trillions of data, and this is the thing, that 90% of the data which has been created in this world has been created in the last 10 years, right? Only 10% was being created before that, right? So a huge set of data which is getting created, which is called big data. Now that big data is useless. You understand? Because what will you do with so much of data? What will you do to understand that where from where to where we have traveled in 3 years back? What this guy did was that he picked up from the big data, the actionable data, and used that for his sales call and made a successful sales call, right? That to me is the essence of digital in sales. The world is changing, the usage of digital is changing, is happening at a huge, huge space, and the sales system previously used to depend on individual skill now need to change and get into a way where it is much more analytics based, logic based, information based, and they are already ready with what they want to do or what they want to approach. So this is more or less what I kind of tried and tell you, and I tell you that some of the examples will be Unilever examples. I don't want to quote from other companies, but I shall bring it alive for all the industry. I know there are people from different industries who are sit here, so I'll try and do that. Now, first, if you look at it, I spoke about this digital explosion. You know, everything today, the kind of data each of you youngsters generating is mind-boggling. Now, all of us are in a way consumers. All of us are in a way shoppers, right? So we are sharing our information to the world outside. How does somebody pick up is something which is important, and I'll try and explain that to you. Now, once you talk about the digital explosion, also if you look at the financial side of it, and I'm sure there are people from the financial industry, the explosion and the equally parallel explosion of fintech which is happening. Today, Nepal, a country of 2.8 crores population, has 40 lakhs of people who use digital payment at a daily basis, right? That's the kind of a movement which is happening, and that's directly linked to sales for the simple fact that the entire fulfillment of sale, and what is fulfillment, I'll try and tell you, is happening once the financial closure is happening there. If you look at the shopper journey, you know, when I joined, it was all about traditional brick and mortar shops, right? And some of you, I can see some seniors sitting over there, and everything was dependent on the salesperson's ability to influence the shopkeeper. Am I right? So how can you convince them, whether it is a shopkeeper, whether it is a distributor, whether it is even in direct selling, in terms of the consumer or the shopper, how do you have one-to-one interaction? Today, this is fast changing. The individual ability, it is not that it is no more important, but that ability definition is getting changed, and we will talk about that because digital is playing a huge role. If you look at today, the way it is changing from a brick and mortar to today, if you look at Nepal, whether it is Daraj, whether it is Sastodil, whether there are other places also, the way a shopper is shopping is changing. Right? Even when somebody is going to a brick and mortar store, in any of the industry, they are comparing that online and going to a brick and mortar store and trying to do their sales call. So hence, the salesperson's job has completely changed. They cannot be completely unaware of what is happening in the digital space and be concerned about what is happening in the brick and mortar stores. No. The entire landscape is changing. Now, when the landscape is changing, also what is happening that it is nothing standalone. There is something which is called omnichannel, which is which will come to Nepal sooner than later, which is catching up globally, which is catching up in South Asia also. That it is not, you cannot say that, okay, this is a brick and mortar. You cannot say that, okay, this is online store. One channel is playing the role of everything. So it can be physically serving a shopper. It can be online serving a shopper. It can be serving a shopper to cash and carry, and so on and so forth. So it is called omnichannel, where every way a shopper is being connected. If you look at today, what this story which I told you about the car sales happened. The salesperson personalized the offer. Am I right? He personalized the offer for my daughter and for me. It is extremely important that personalization is happening because the ability to understand your shopper is easier through digital operations. You can know your shopper. You can something which is called experiential. So it is not that the shopper wants to experience and wants to experience digitally before he or she makes the decision. I'll give you one example. This is one example of there is no sound. This is an example of Daraz, you know. So this is a Sunsilk activation which is happening in the Daraz site, where the shopper is being, on the digital side, the shopper is being given the experience of the influencer, and basis that the shopper is making a decision, right? So the challenge and the way to address it is completely different, and the cost and the efficiency, I shall speak about it in details in terms of the efficiency, becomes so important, because today a shopper compares with the help of digital compares much frequently than what they used to do earlier. Previously, the neighborhood store or the neighborhood shop which somebody knows used to be our go-to place. Today, comparing it is so easy with the advent of digital that the challenge for new people are completely, completely different. I never faced this challenge when I was in direct sales. Your job is much more difficult because you are facing a much informed shopper, a much difficult challenge to handle. What is this stop clock and why this is not changing? What you need to do, now quickly what I'll tell you, that as a sales process, how does it work and how do you want to kind of break it in smaller steps? First is the demand capture. For a salesperson, it is extremely important to understand that where is the demand, to capture that demand. And you know, that capturing can only happen, I'm not saying can only happen, but should happen logically when you are finding out that it is not that you close your eye and go to 10 places or to 10 of your customers and find out where is the demand and serve them. You should know where you are going and where there will be the demand. That brings in that much of efficiency for you. The second point is demand fulfillment. Today, your customers are extremely, extremely demanding in terms of fulfillment. A day late, even an hour late, look at Food Mandu. Look at the people who are doing the Food Mandu. Even if it is 15 minutes late or half an hour late, what do? We call up, we question, right? So demand fulfillment is an extremely, extremely important part for the sales system, and digital plays a huge role in this process. It is a complete misnomer that demand cannot be generated by the sales system. Generally, it is thought that demand generation is marketing job and sales job is fulfillment, right? It is a complete misnomer. Now, at the point of purchase, and when I'm talking about the point of purchase, it can be the physical store, it can be the digital store, lots of ways the sales system can generate demand, right? And I shall try and speak about it. At the end of it, the people in sales remains as much important, you know? If the digital cannot take away that and should not take away that, it is a combination. It is not binary. It is not either or. It has to stay, and we will speak about that. And finally, every time our youngsters keep it in mind, the most crucial part in my mind is that building your own capability. If the world is changing, you have to change faster. You have to adapt faster. You have to understand, you have to almost predict what is going to happen. When I'm talking about you, it is about you and your organization needs to predict what is happening. Today, Unilever globally, we have said a couple of years back that we are extremely, extremely backdated as far as digital is concerned. And we need to, we are a fantastic marketeer, and we have been told, and I'm not sure, we have been told that we are good marketeer, we have been told that we are very good at lots of other things, must be. We are a 55 billion euro company. But on digital, we have identified that is our soft spot. As of yesterday evening, I left office at 6:30. I finished the third chapter of 5-chapter digital leadership training program, which I have to finish by next Friday. Right? We have to be ready in order to face that, face this changing world. And my request to all of you is that there are so much available, whether it is in the LinkedIn platform, whether it is so many platforms. I can see this particular platform which we are talking about, it enhances your capability, right? So it is extremely important to work on your capability. Now I shall quickly talk about the demand capture. The first and foremost thing of demand capture is to find out what is called coverage. Where do you need to go? How do you find out where is demand? And how do we do that? You know, I'll give you an example of our own example. Previously, when you used to expand outlet, so the population, I'll give an example of a population of India. So the population of India when it was 90 crores, and today India population is 130 crores, do you think the number of outlets have remained the same? No, no. In every field, our number of outlets have increased. If it has increased, then how do you find them? One way of finding them is to kind of a move around in the geography, and if there is an uncovered place, in whichever, whether it is, in whichever way, then you forward that. Another way of finding is that, how do you use the science and the data? And I'll give an example of the data. We know that per lakh population, there should be X number of stores in Y population. Getting a bit complex. So I would say that, say in a metro situation, say in a Kathmandu situation, every lakh of population should have 250 outlets, right? But when you go to a smaller town, right, the number of outlet per lakh comes down. Right? That's the science. What we did was that we tagged each of our outlet which we cover through GPS. So every outlet of ours is GPS tagged, right? And then what we did, what we do is that we cover a geography, we know that this is the geography we are covering. These are the number of outlets which we are covering. The population of the geography is X. Ideally, as per formula, there should be Y number of outlets. We are covering X number of outlets. So there is a headroom or there is no headroom. You are understanding the way digital is playing the role in terms of finding out something very basic and telling us, and you can do it at a word level. You understand word in the municipality, there are words, so, and words populations are also being captured, so you can do it at a word level. look at other industries. The other industries also can find out if somebody is opening a hotel, if somebody is opening an automobile stores, right? Then this kind of a data of the population in that particular geography will tell you where you have headroom and where the headroom is lesser. I'll give you a very interesting example. Post-COVID, how many of you know about Google Mobility? How many of you heard about Google Mobility? Okay, friends, you need to kind of get into these terms, and these terms are extremely important. So Google Mobility tells you, you know about Google Map? All of you know Google Map? So Google Mobility tells you, in a particular geography, what is the movement of the people and where all people are going. So they are going to a grocery store, they are going to food stores, they are going to different other types of stores, and so on and so forth. They are going to hospitals, they are going to... Post-COVID, we didn't have the ability to bring back our distribution to the pre-COVID level immediately because we had lesser number of people, right? In Kathmandu, what we did was that we looked at the Google Mobility at a daily level. And we found out that which geography is getting more mobility, more people are going to the stores in which geography. And we decided that, okay, in this geography, we will increase our coverage fast. We found out, it was a fantastic insight, and it was being shared with me, that the mobility of people in the non-Kathmandu part of Nepal was building faster than that of Kathmandu, right? So the people in Pokhara, the people in other places, Birganj and all, they are coming out of COVID and moving out and starting their daily activities much earlier than the people who are in Kathmandu. So we strengthened our distribution, coverage, everything there fast, put our resources there first, and then basis that we deployed. 20 years back or 15 years back, what we would have done? Perhaps completely the opposite. First Kathmandu, the biggest market, put all your power in Kathmandu. Am I right? That's logical, but we did it completely differently. That's the power of digital in sales. That is what we need to adopt as a sales system. And this is what we call intelligence in expansion. It is not mindless. Don't do it mindless. Bring in, you have information, use that information to do it. Right? First, when we, now once we say that, okay, we have expanded, then it is necessary for the sales system to understand what should we say. Again, let me give you an example, and I am inspired by that fantastic stories telling, sir. I was enjoying this thing, so let me also try my hand. So, in my last role as a general manager of East India, as a director of East India, I went to an outlet when I first took over. And that outlet was so happy that, okay, a senior person from the Unilever has come to work in my outlet and all. After spending 20-30 minutes, what he did, you know, he picked up a plastic bag and gave it to me and said that, sir, aap idhar ho, aap apna sales story, I'm using some local language because they, aap idhar ho, to aap apna logo ko bolo to take this away from me. This is blocking my capital. Ye mera paisa block karke rakha hua. So I asked them, what is this? Then I realized, we as an organization, we said that we need to increase the assortment. We have to sell more lines, we have to sell more products to more outlets. What our salesman did was that they picked up one product of each of our SKU, and we have 890 SKUs. SKU means the selling unit. And gave it to the shopkeeper saying that, ye mere liye le lo, please take it for me. And relationship, you know, the shopkeeper picked up, kept it. It doesn't sell in his outlet. Right? If you are giving shampoo conditioner to a pawn shop. Will it sell? But the shopkeeper might say that, okay, bol raha hai, pura full year he works with me, so I'll keep his word. That is the traditional way of selling, right? Now, how, understand how wrong it is. You need to sell the products which sales and generates further order, replenishment, You need to sell basis your replenishment. And even your debt needs to be that. Previously we used to say, we had a sales, every salesperson, any salesperson over here who doesn't have a sales target, please raise, I'll take a photograph, I can see others can sign photograph, his photograph. So all of us, we have targets. So we force things. Again, that period is over. It just blocks capital. I'll tell you, this is something which we operate as an organization, and I'll give you this example and how it happens. You know what it is doing? It is churning data in a particular outlet and saying that this outlet, ultimately, what is the right assortment product and what is the right quantity we should sell in that outlet. And the salesman is supposed to only fulfill that demand. Today he is not held responsible for how much he has sold. He is held responsible for how many perfect outlets. What is the assortment, right assortment you have created in those outlets, right? And this is fact for everybody. What kind of a car will you keep with your car dealers in a particular geography? Look at the paint industry, right? I have lots of friends from the paint industry, and I have been told that lots of time the shade, the color is being determined by the local, like if a mandir in that particular place, if a temple in that particular place has certain color, then the local person preferred to use that color in that geography, right? In this way, look at the temperature, how it changes between Kathmandu and say a bordering India sub-geography. Would you sell the same quantity of seasonal product, what you sell in Kathmandu, the same way you sell it in Biratnagar? No. And that the data gives you, tells you that, okay, this is what the optimal quantity of a certain product which you should sell to an outlet based on his history and certain other external factors, right? So that is what is called intelligent selling. That is challenging the traditional way of selling which we have grown up, right? Execution. I'll not speak much about it because this is the most important thing, for the fact that just taking order. Now, let me ask you another question. What is important that you can raise your... You have taken an order today. To deliver the order tomorrow, we take order at a certain period in the intervals every week. Say every week or every month we collect order. Am I right? So is it important to deliver it on the next day? Or is it important to deliver it on an agreed day? I'll not start a vote. Our understanding is that it is important to deliver the order on an agreed day. Because accordingly, to whom he was selling, he or she will plan. Right? Look at today, again I'm going back to the car industry, and I'm sorry for it. The salespeople in the car industry, and this is my personal feeling, not everybody, some of them, what they do is that they book the order. And they say that, okay, this will be delivered in 3 months' time. And that then the 3 months can go 6 months, and they pass on the responsibility by saying, sir, mera job to order lena tha. I have taken the order and passed it on to the company. See, now the company is delaying. No. Your job is not fulfilled till the entire process is closed, including collecting the money for that order. It is not, sales is not siloed. And this entire thing happens, the digital can help you. You must be wondering, what is this map? This map is all about when we take orders and we service, like in Nepal, we service almost 55,000 outlets. You know, so every week we have to service 55,000 outlets. Manually, it is not possible to find out what is the optimal route for the delivery. So the GPS tagged outlet, the route is being defined, that today you are not necessarily every outlet will give order every day, right? So the GPS route defines and tells us that, okay, this is the optimal route of your fulfillment, right? This is how a digital plays today in our life, every day in an everyday outlet. I have already spoken about fulfillment. This is what I was telling you about, that the cost of delay, the cost of inefficiency in the fulfillment can be really, really killing, right? It can not only create a bad impression for your customers, but a word of mouth is important. And hence, what digital allows you to decide an optimal route or the optimal way of fulfillment, which is much more efficient, then you have to go and drop during Dasari. I'll take an out of business example. During Dasari, you give to your relatives. So you decided that, okay, we will go to 8 houses today and give to 8 relatives, right? If those 8 houses are GPS tagged, the map will tell you your fulfillment, your delivery. What is the most efficient way, what is the most efficient route to deliver and fulfill your order? That is what is the role of digital in this space. If you look at now, I said this, that this is a misnomer, that sales system cannot generate demand. Definitely they can. If you look at this particular example, I'll tell you what is happening. So in this particular process, what you are doing, the lady is doing, she is making a simple phone call. What is happening at the end of the phone call? When you do a two-caller phone call or a Viber phone call, what happens? At the end of the phone call, there is a banner, right? The banner says who you called or from whom you have received the call, and there is a banner. In this process, what is happening is that in that banner, when you are putting the product, it is also giving you a one-click opportunity to go, if you like the product, in this particular case it is Pond's Bright Beauty. If you like the product, you click it, you go to Daras, you place your order, and the process is fulfilled. Right? So a simple act of where you catch your shopper, a simple act of phone call can digitally lead you to a sales, and the fulfillment also is being taken care by the delivery agency, right? So that's how you can use the digital. So there are importance in terms of in-store activation, importance in terms of, huge importance in terms of proper analysis. The other day, in this particular stage, I was having another meeting with Kamuk, or some of you will know Amlan. He is the promoter of Sastodhi. So Amlan was, we were discussing, and Amlan was, you know, Amlan was not pitching his sales volume. He was saying that, I know that for Unilever or a company like that, I will be contributing 3-4% of the turnover, may not be more. What I'm pitching is that the kind of a data which we can give you, the consumer profile which we can give you, the number of customers which they come to my site and I can analyze and give you that data is for me, that data is absolutely, absolutely invaluable. Yesterday, I had a presentation where a strategy in terms of channels, sales channels, been created. You know by what? I'll again use a term, I'm sorry if I'm using some of those terms, by social hearing. What is social hearing? All the discussions which happens in the social side, whether it is Instagram, whether it is Viber, or whether it is Facebook and all, it can be coded. It gets there again to the big data. And it is analyzed and said that, okay, people prefer to buy you this product from that channel. Right? And it is possible in Nepal. And it is happening in Nepal. Right? What you guys, all of you need to do is that you need to really understand your shopper. The shopper is the king. Offtake will give you right data. And then use that data for your sales plan. I'll show you one example of an activation which happened in India, which is Cadbury's, it is in public space. This is a bit of a longish video. I have time, another 5 minutes, sir. I'll show you this activation and then I'll explain to you. Understand at what level a digital can move and help a shopkeeper and then pose a challenge to you saying that your shopkeeper, okay, I'll not tell this, I'll first play this and then I'll tell you, I'll explain.